Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Chinese Communist Espionage, an Intelligence Primer, by Matthew Brazil and Peter Mattis, narrated by David DeVries. Preface. This book is the result of collaboration between Peter Mattis, an analyst of the Modern People's Republic of China, PRC, intelligence community, and Matthew Brazil, a historian of early Chinese Communist Party, CCP, intelligence operations, and a former corporate investigator. We hope that this material will be of interest to those seeking a clearer understanding of how China conducts espionage. Even though everyone spies, the methods by which the PRC pursues secret intelligence are too often shrouded in unnecessary mystery. This can lead to miscalculation, misunderstanding, and prejudice by governments protecting national security information and businesses protecting trade secrets. Perhaps more importantly, it distorts and harms bilateral relations between China and its important diplomatic and trading partners, particularly the United States and Japan. The mystery is partly of our own making. This field is neglected by China watchers, sometimes to avoid somehow upsetting commerce or other institutional relations with China, but also because of the thin veil of the Chinese language. Many recently published works on Chinese espionage in English fail to pierce that veil or even to give it a fair go, using few, if any, Chinese language sources. It is as if someone in Beijing wrote a book about the U.S. intelligence community without examining English language sources. We have consulted numerous Chinese publications, books, and other materials. However, we believe that we have only scratched the surface. Few are more aware than the handful of authors who have delved into this arena of the vast and unexplored range of published Chinese language works on intelligence, unofficial Samizdat-type literature, and unopened archives that will eventually bring additional clarity to this murky world. However, we hope that we have begun a more critical analysis of this darker corner of Chinese communist history and governance than is evident in the increasingly mythologized accounts that have come out of Beijing in recent times. In writing a reference guide, we do not intend to provide the definitive answers, but rather to introduce the history of intelligence within the CCP and the modern party state, systematically sketching the key figures, organizations, and espionage cases, invites listeners to draw their own conclusions about PRC intelligence services, their activities, and their methods. By contrast, much of the existing analysis and commentary about Chinese intelligence is anecdotal or drawn from the observations of security professionals who cannot speak freely. The experience of these professionals often is limited to a fraction of the PRC's clandestine activity. Focusing only on economic espionage, the activities of intelligence services, United Front work, or theft in cyberspace would result in misleading conclusions about what the PRC does in each of the other areas, reminiscent of the parable of the elephant and the blind men. By contrast, we make a broader attempt to explain what today's PRC intelligence services do and the roots of their work in CCP history. The value of a reference guide lies in making a lot of data easily accessible. Between the limitations of English language works and the narrow lens through which most security professionals look at PRC intelligence, there is a need to shine a light across the breadth and historical depth of this activity. The needs of the present often require journalists and analysts to emphasize the new rather than the continuous. We hope this reference guide enables those who must meet the needs of today to see both continuity and novelty with greater clarity. The views expressed in this book are the author's alone and not those of the U.S. government, CECC, or anyone in them. Introduction. For the employees of a certain Chinese government ministry in Beijing, the coldest day of 2011 was not in winter. It was on the morning that all personnel were ordered to view the execution of one of their comrades, who had been exposed as a spy for the Central Intelligence Agency, CIA, and his pregnant wife. The two were shot in the ministry's interior courtyard, the proceedings shown on closed-circuit television. The man's sentence was only one of a dozen or more lethal warnings to the Chinese bureaucracy between late 2010 and December 2012. The state and the ruling Chinese Communist Party, CCP, would not tolerate disloyalty by those entrusted with its secrets. There would be no mercy, even for the unborn child of a traitor. The forces of state security had destroyed CIA networks in China, and woe to anyone who tried to revive them. Why does the CCP react in such a vociferous and lethal manner to a crime that would draw only a prison sentence elsewhere? One answer lies in how close the party has come to being destroyed by betrayal, whether from allies or spies within. For Americans and others in the West, foreign espionage and related intelligence failures have been perilous, but have not really been threats to national existence. The Japanese attack in Hawaii on December 7, 1941, shook the U.S. government and especially its intelligence establishment, which vowed never to be so surprised again, though September 11, 2001 might qualify as a reminder. In both cases, the United States may have stumbled, but these intelligence setbacks did not prevent the nation from recovering and fighting back hard. The CCP had its own versions of Pearl Harbor and September 11, but by contrast, they almost destroyed communism in China. They underline how intelligence, defined as useful information and analytic products to guide decisions regarding an enemy, and security, protective measures against hostile acts, began to blend in Chinese party and state organizations. On April 12, 1927, the party was surprised almost to death by what it called a counter-revolutionary coup. The perpetrators were the CCP's erstwhile allies, the Chinese Nationalist Party, KMT, whose soldiers and police rounded up and executed thousands of communists in Shanghai and other cities. The Nationalists called it the 1927 Party Cleansing, when they rid themselves of infiltrators who intended to subvert and overthrow the KMT leadership. At the end of the coup, the CCP had only 2,000 to 3,000 soldiers remaining, and its overall membership dropped from 60,000 to 10,000. But two decades later, Mao Zedong's CCP kicked the Nationalists out of mainland China, in part by planting countless spies inside the Nationalist government to rot it from within. The April 12 incident in 1927 led to the birth of the Red Army on August 1 and the founding later that year of clandestine operations, assassination squads, and finally a professional intelligence service that absorbed them, the Special Services Section, SSS. Today's ministries of state security and public security consider the SSS to be their predecessor. The struggles of the SSS to survive and gather enemy intelligence form important parts of the party's founding narrative. The successes celebrated today are not entirely hyperbole and are vital to understanding both the history of Chinese communism and the behavior of the contemporary Chinese party state with its impressive surveillance apparatus. The early years of the SSS were marked by hard-earned gains and lucky breaks to collect intelligence on the KMT and maintain the party's underground presence inside China's cities. In April 1931, the SSS's greatest operational success clashed with its greatest failure. From 1929, the service ran a small three-man spy ring, now known as the Three Heroes of the Dragon's Lair, Longtong Sanjia, in the heart of the KMT's intelligence apparatus. The intelligence provided by these men, Jian Zhuangfei, Li Kenong, and Hu Di, allowed the communists operating in the cities to stay a step ahead of KMT security organs. Jian in particular furnished actionable intelligence because his talent and origins earned him a job as the private secretary for Xu Ensang, Yu Tishu, the chief of KMT intelligence. From this vantage point, he saw everything that crossed Xu's desk and more. Assassinations and mayhem, however, were as much the province of the SSS as any delicate intelligence operation. The SSS operations section, Tsingdongke, murdered collaborators, set off car bombs, and assassinated KMT officials. These Red Brigades, or dog-beating squads as they became known, attracted at least as many thugs as committed communists. Gu Xuanzheng, its guiding light, who doubled as SSS director, was one of the former, despite his labor activism. A talented magician and master of disguise, Gu also participated directly in the section's operations. In April 1931, local KMT security officials in Wuhan recognized and arrested him. Gu knew as well as anyone that he faced torture and death at the hands of the KMT and agreed to cooperate. He warned his captors, however, that they should remain silent about his arrest until he could be brought to KMT intelligence headquarters in Nanjing. Gu knew of Cian and the two other heroes, but did not identify them. Gu's captors ignored his advice and cabled Nanjing, crowing over their success in capturing the CCP's head spy. The telegrams arrived at Chu's office after he had departed for the day and fell into the hands of Jiang Zhuangfei. CCP knowledge of Gu's capture and agreement to cooperate spurred a frantic rush to vacate urban hideouts. Gu had a detailed knowledge not just of his section and its work, but also of the CCP's underground infrastructure across China's cities. Communist safe houses, communications protocols, true names and aliases, cover organizations, and spies within the KMT, all were in Gu's head. Cian, Li, and Hu's cover may have been blown, but not before Cian gave the CCP at least a 12-hour head start. That lead time allowed the communists to begin destroying relevant documents and ordering cadres to flee the city. The three heroes of the Dragon's Lair saved the urban CCP leadership in spite of the failure of vetting and indoctrination to identify Gu Xuanzheng's unreliability. Meanwhile, Mao and the Red Army remained safely out of reach in the remote mountains of Jiangxi, to which the leadership retreated. However, the damage Gu wrought nearly destroyed the party's urban presence. The KMT central government rounded up thousands of communists in the cities, though key figures such as future Premier Zhou Enlai, future five-star General Chang Gong, and Chen Yuan escaped the dragnet. As a number of party luminaries, such as Mao Zedong and Marshal Ya Jianying, would later note, the three heroes' spy ring changed the course of the Chinese Revolution by saving key cadre. The episode has engendered countless books, essays, and movies because it is a place where historical truth and propagandistic convenience overlap. The party narratives, however, are less forthcoming about the subsequent collapse of the SSS, even as they applaud the KMT's execution of Gu sometime in 1935. Gu's defection critically weakened SSS operations, and the party disbanded the unit in 1935. As the locus of CCP power shifted to the countryside and the Jiangxi Soviet, so too did the party's intelligence apparatus. Many of those brought in to run the Political Protection Bureau, PPB, under the Central Committee, and the Second Bureau of the Central Revolutionary Military Commission, CRMC, the forerunner of today's Central Military Commission, CMC, began their intelligence careers in the SSS. Cian Zhuangfei ran the Bureau's training program in radio interception and analysis. Li Kenong also served as a CRMC deputy director and as head of the Jiangxi province branch of the PPB. Others, such as Chen Yun, Kang Sheng, and Pan Hanyan, would fight a rear guard action in the cities to preserve the CCP's intelligence operations before fleeing to communist base areas. The CRMC Second Bureau would become similarly legendary for saving the party during the KMT encirclement campaigns, 1930-34, and the Long March. Although the impact of this military intelligence department cannot be denied, most approved Chinese sources obfuscate the reasons for the Second Bureau's successes in exploiting KMT communications. For many years, the KMT did not encipher their communications, sending messages entirely in the clear. This allowed the Second Bureau to intercept enemy radio traffic, build a comprehensive order of battle, be alert to enemy operations, and locate their units. As the KMT introduced ciphers, the Second Bureau did not develop a strong deciphering capability, but rather learned to exploit captured and stolen code books. The successes of Red Army operations during the Long March seemed to correlate directly with where the Second Bureau could rely on its existing order of battle knowledge and enemy ciphers. If SSS operations demonstrated the value of intelligence in protecting the party, then the Second Bureau showed the value of integrating command and intelligence to seize the initiative and use the smaller Red Army effectively against superior forces. The CRMC Second Bureau began the history of the People's Liberation Army, PLA, intelligence apparatus. Today's Intelligence Bureau in the Joint Staff Department and Strategic Support Force would see themselves as direct descendants. Although the history of military intelligence falls strangely silent for much of the period between the end of the Long March in 1935 and the founding of the People's Republic of China, PRC, in 1949, intelligence remained an important brace for Red Army leadership. During the Liao Shen Campaign, 1948, in the Northeast, Lin Biao would travel with intelligence personnel as part of his command train. Peng Dehui, while in command of the 8th Route Army in 1940 in eastern China, told newly arrived civilian intelligence personnel that they reported to him and his intelligence chief rather than to their own headquarters in Yan'an. In short, the CCP early on understood the value of intelligence for the party's security and military operations. Understanding these early years is critical for two reasons. First, since 1927, the CCP has considered intelligence a professional activity that requires dedicated organizations to conduct it. Even as these organizations were established and eventually eroded, another organization always arose to take up the mantle. The SSS was absorbed into the Political Protection Bureau, which also shared personnel with the CRMC Second Bureau. Some officers in each moved into the successor Social Affairs Department, the Red Army's General Staff, the 8th Route Army's intelligence units, and so on, almost to the present day. Only after the founding of the PRC in 1949 did clearer lines start to emerge between the party, state, and military intelligence units with distinct career patterns. Second, the heroes of these operations and veterans of these organizations played key roles in Chinese intelligence until their deaths. This founding generation of intelligence officers remained active into the 1980s. Premier Zhou Enlai, the first SSS director, involved himself in domestic and foreign intelligence operations almost until his death in 1976. Liang Guangpu, who led the General Staff Department's Intelligence Bureau from 1978 to 1982, ran the CRMC Second Bureau's Wireless Training Academy in Zhejin in the early 1930s. Li Kanong, one of the three heroes of the Dragon's Lair, would wear both party and military intelligence hats throughout the rest of his career until his death in 1962. And he contributed to the first operational histories and training materials as Chinese intelligence professionalized in the late 1930s. Many other names, for example, Ya Junying, Wu Shuquan, Liao Chengzhe, Luo Qingcheng, appear repeatedly throughout this history for their roles in shaping the relationship between decision makers and intelligence officers, as well as the process of intelligence. Troubled politics, troubled intelligence. Looking back at the history of the CCP since its founding in 1921, several themes emerge that are useful to understand the effect of Chinese communist intelligence and security operations on the party's development and on modern China itself. Closely weighing these themes has helped us separate the CCP's propaganda line from what can be discerned from reliable and validated data and what can be inferred, and from matters where only an informed guess is possible. The first theme is often termed read versus expert. This widespread tension between those of proven political loyalty and the technically competent was evident early in the revolution and took different forms that did not specifically denigrate expertise per se until after 1956. A variant on this theme that heavily influenced CCP intelligence is tension between the party's ideologues and counter-spies on the one hand, and its intelligence professionals and the highly trained secret agents they dispatched on the other. Intelligence officers and agents who were successful in gathering enemy secrets did so in part by cultivating contacts with the other side, including liars, thieves, smugglers, drug dealers, and, of course, traitors. In a stinging irony, by successfully stealing enemy secrets, these communist officers and agents exposed themselves, in the best of times, to doubts about their loyalty. In the worst of times, ideologues and counter-spies who seldom, if ever, had to leave the safety of the CCP's base areas purged their own intelligence people for doing their jobs, motivated at least in part by the radical policy prescriptions and, at times, the paranoia of Mao Zedong. This was the fate of senior intelligence official Pan Hanyan after he confessed in 1955 to not reporting an important meeting 12 years earlier with Wang Jingwei, the leader of the Japanese puppet government. Between 800 and 1,000 CCP intelligence officers and agents were demoted, fired, or imprisoned in the subsequent purge ordered by Mao. The 1955 intelligence purge was just the first wave in a series of losses in the ranks of the PRC intelligence community. Later that year, Zhou Enlai conceived and Mao Zedong approved a reorganization that led to the founding of the party's first permanent foreign intelligence organ, the Central Investigation Department, CID. In the following decade, the organization grew, built standard procedures, and forged interagency cooperation. But when the Cultural Revolution began in 1966, the CID was not exempted from the chaos. Rival Red Guard factions formed within the department, each competing with the other to represent true adherence to Mao's thought. As the radical left under Mao's wife, Jiang Qing, and the Cultural Revolution group ascended, almost the entire senior leadership of the CID was purged. Fighting within forced Zhou and Mao to engineer a military takeover of the department in March 1967 to protect its secrets from leaking off premises and into Red Guard newspapers. The death of Mao in 1976 and the end of the Cultural Revolution did not end purges in the intelligence field. The next house cleaning was directed against an unknown number of Cultural Revolutionary beneficiaries, chiefly Luo Qingchang, the new CID director and the only senior intelligence leader from 1966 who survived the deluge. But Luo hung on for years, just as in the rest of society, leftists did not simply withdraw in shame and fear with the December 1978 return of Deng Xiaoping to the party's core leadership. In fact, Luo resisted change. Notably, he encouraged subordinates to ignore a speech made by Deng at a foreign affairs conference the next summer where he urged intelligence reforms and enhanced clandestine operations outside of PRC embassies. Luo was finally ousted for good in 1983 with the formation of the Ministry of State Security, MSS, though to this day he retains an inexplicably honored place in CCP intelligence history. However, the three purges in 1955, 1967, and 1983 produced an unmeasured decline in talent available to the PRC intelligence community as it shifted from a place in the party to a government ministry under the State Council. These purges, extending even beyond Mao Zedong's rule, reflect how the party's struggle, criticism, transformation ideal continues to drive events. That often gruesome influence on Chinese communist intelligence operations can still be observed. Intelligence into the modern era. The politics of the MSS's establishment in 1983 coincided with Deng Xiaoping's policy of reform and opening that increased China's engagement with the outside world. In 1975, Deng began drafting plans for the four modernizations, agriculture, industry, science, and national defense, to make China rich and powerful. These modernization programs required importing technical and managerial knowledge from advanced capitalist economies. How to do this was unknown. China's break from the Soviet Union in the 1950s led to policies of self-sufficiency and undermined the party's leaders' ability to understand the outside world. With relatively few important diplomatic relationships and weakened intelligence resources, Deng's China needed to both experiment diplomatically and to educate its own leadership about the outside world. China's intelligence apparatus, however, was ill-prepared to support these intelligence needs. The aforementioned purges had reduced the size and the operational knowledge of the civilian intelligence cadre. Moreover, when the civilian ministries and the party bureaucracy were disbanded in 1967, one of two things happened. Either agents lost contact with their handlers, and in some cases only reconnected a decade later with mixed successes in maintaining the intelligence relationship, or the PLA General Staff Department's Second Bureau, 2PLA, took over the handling of many CID agents, and there is no sign that the agents necessarily returned to civilian control when the party bureaucracy stood back up. When the MSS was created a few years later, its personnel came predominantly from the counterintelligence elements of the Ministry of Public Security, MPS. Even the first minister, Ling Yun, came from an internal security background. Although the information is sketchy, Deng Xiaoping appears to have turned to his friends in the military for intelligence. During Deng's brief rehabilitation in 1975 as the PLA chief of the General Staff, he brought intelligence veteran and former diplomat Wu Shouchuan back as a deputy chief of the General Staff and as 2PLA director. Wu expanded 2PLA's open-source intelligence in 1979 by creating the Beijing, now China, Institute for International and Strategic Studies to collect and analyze the strategy of the Soviet Union and other major countries. Other significant 2PLA leaders, such as Liu Guangfu, 1978-82, Zhang Zhonggru, 1982-85, and Cao Xin, 1985-88, began their careers under the CRMC Second Bureau or the Eighth Route Army, and some, such as Cao and Wu, served directly with Deng. These connections are not the only indicators that Deng relied on the military for intelligence. The PLA dominated the major externally facing leading small groups, most notably those for Taiwan and foreign affairs, which set overall policy guidance. The Minister of State Security would not join the foreign affairs leading small group until the mid to late 1990s, isolating the ministry. Although the MSS chiefs were politically reliable, there is no indication that they were the kind of political heavyweights who did not need a formal position to be influential. In 1985, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, echoing Deng's 1979 speech on foreign affairs, argued the MSS presence in official missions should be reduced and operationally restricted, lest the discovery of its operations derail the foreign relationships critical to Deng's modernization program. Deng's reliance on the PLA cemented the military's role as the primary foreign intelligence provider. But it had a few unintended consequences that reverberate to the present day. Focusing on foreign intelligence advanced the careers of 2PLA defense attachés, creating a cadre of military intelligence leaders led by Xiong Guangkai, who had little to no experience in military operations. From 1988 to 2006, the defense attachés led PLA intelligence, even overseeing the signals intelligence apparatus. In one sense, this new generation of intelligence officers were PLA outsiders. For example, Xiong spent much of his early career abroad as a defense attaché and in analytic positions at 2PLA headquarters. He served and was educated entirely within military intelligence. His predecessor as deputy chief of the General Staff with the intelligence portfolio, Xu Xin, however, served in a broader range of positions. Xu originally was an infantry officer serving in Deng's division in the 8th Root Army and was a veteran of the Korean War. Ironically, Deng's reliance on the PLA at the expense of the MSS created the conditions for the politicization of military intelligence in the 1990s. The rise of 2PLA's role in foreign intelligence, 2PLA for years was known as China CIA, dragged the military intelligence apparatus further away from military operations. As Xiong rose to the top and saw little room for advancement, he attached himself to CCP General Secretary Jiang Zemin. As an outsider himself, Jiang needed to know more about the PLA leadership and whether to trust them. With Deng's help, Jiang faced down a military coup in 1993 and, thanks in part to PLA actions, initiated crises with the United States in 1995, 1996, 1999, and 2001. The limited records of these crises suggest the PLA was less than forthcoming with Jiang, if not at times outright deceptive. Xiong reportedly availed himself of the PLA's Signals Intelligence Department to spy on other military leaders and furnished Jiang with reporting on what the military leadership was actually doing. Jiang even tried to move Xiong to take over the MSS in 1998, but other leaders balked at the idea of a clear partisan running the MSS, and Xiong stayed in the military. The Jiang-Xiong relationship cemented the military's role at the center, leaving little room for other ministries to play a meaningful role in foreign intelligence. Absent political interest to remove the MSS's operational restrictions and expand its presence abroad, the ministry largely focused on domestic consolidation. When the MSS was created in 1983, it consisted of the central headquarters and a small number of local state security departments. The MSS covered only about half the country at the provincial level by the end of the 1980s, and even less at local levels. The 1990s, however, saw the final consolidation across the provincial and local levels. Most of the expansion came at the expense of the MPS. Many MPS officers were police one day, intelligence officers the next. Current Minister of State Security Chen Wenqing was one of those officials. Chen began his career in counterespionage at the Sichuan Public Security Department, but was moved into the Sichuan State Security Department when it was created around 1993-94. The consolidation of PLA intelligence to support China's leadership and the MSS domestic expansion did little to resolve some of the major challenges for Chinese intelligence. Except for tactical intelligence embedded with operational units, military intelligence oriented itself to support policy rather than military operations. U.S. and Allied military operations in the Persian Gulf War in 1991 demonstrated that modern militaries needed robust, real-time intelligence capabilities to exploit missiles and precision-guided munitions, and militaries without those capabilities were dangerously vulnerable. Party leadership, however, trumped military decision-makers, even as the latter began formulating aggressive modernization programs to make the PLA capable of information-enabled operations comparable to those executed by the United States and other advanced militaries. The influx of MPS personnel into the MSS highlighted the need for better training and education programs. Although much of the MSS's work on a day-to-day basis qualified as internal security and counterintelligence with directly transferable skills, domestic intelligence skills are not as readily transferable to foreign operations or handling foreign sources. Minister of State Security Chia Chun-Wang, 1985-98, began commissioning research for unclassified books and articles to capture the historical legacy and lessons of CCP intelligence by 1992. But these works would not begin appearing until several years later. The PLA and the MSS, however, started making investments in the mid-1990s that would pay off much later. Companies such as Beijing TopSec, Network Security Technology Company, founded in November 1995, and Venus Tech, founded in 1996, reportedly received startup funding from the government. These early network security firms produced China's first indigenous security tools, such as network sensors and firewalls. They also were brought into a network of companies around the China National Information Technology Security Evaluation Center, CNITSEC, which was established in 1997. Ostensibly a national standards center for evaluating vulnerabilities, CNITSEC appears to be the public-facing organization for the MSS Bureau responsible for computer network exploitation and network defense. These organizations became the center of a web of public-private partnerships and contracts that China's intelligence services used to obscure their activities in cyberspace. At the time, however, these were just long-term bets on a handful of bright researchers. This bet would become fundamental to Chinese intelligence a decade later, but the results would be especially important for the MSS. The reform and opening era for Chinese intelligence was a time for rebuilding, and Beijing's leaders went with the capabilities they had. Relying heavily on the military intelligence apparatus created imbalance across the system. Without a large number of experienced intelligence professionals, the MSS more closely resembled another national police force than a sophisticated intelligence service with worldwide reach. The MSS never quite escaped the consequences of its predecessors' past politics and purges, ceding the field to military intelligence. Emerging as a global intelligence power. As the millennium turned, China's economic dynamism and international presence steadily increased and then accelerated after China's accession to the World Trade Organization in 2001. In 2005, U.S. Deputy Secretary of State Robert Zoellick gave a remarkable speech clarifying the purpose of the U.S.-China relationship. Zoellick stated the U.S. goal should be to integrate China into the international system as a responsible stakeholder. The specifics of the speech were less relevant than Washington's recognition that Beijing was a force with which to be reckoned and on the way to becoming an equal. There was no sign, however, that Chinese intelligence was keeping pace with the country's needs. Military intelligence was still captured by the needs of the central leadership, even as PLA writings about modernization highlighted an outsized role for intelligence in modern operations. Some MSS provincial departments were rumored to have started special training programs for foreign intelligence operations, but nothing in the publicly available espionage case records suggests that a newfound sophistication started to emerge. The mismatch between China's intelligence capabilities, their organizational distribution, and requirements for intelligence support would begin to shift shortly after the baton was passed from Jiang Zemin to Hu Jintao. This process began in 2002 with the 16th Party Congress, when Hu replaced Jiang as the CCP General Secretary. Jiang, however, held on to the chairmanship of the CMC, giving him effective control over the PLA. That Jiang-Xiang relationship consequently continued to shape military intelligence, and there was little Hu could do about it. The two power centers, however, created a command problem for the PLA. Because the CMC chairman decided military policy and signed off on operations, while the PLA ostensibly was loyal to the party general secretary. The PLA helped engineer Jiang's formal retirement from the CMC in September 2004, paving the way for the PLA, and probably Hu, to sideline Xiong for the purpose of redirecting its intelligence organizations toward PLA priorities. The retirement of Lieutenant General Xiong Guangkai, the deputy chief of the general staff with the intelligence portfolio in December 2005, provided the first public indicator that change was coming. Xiong's replacement, Zhang Qinshang, came to the position without any intelligence background. This introduction of an operations officer into senior intelligence roles was the first of several changes to career pathways as the PLA slowly reasserted itself over its intelligence apparatus. Although Zhang only stayed in the position for a short time before his promotion to command the Guangzhou military region, his successors, Ma Xiaojian, Ci Jiangguo, and Sun Jiangguo, all came from outside military intelligence. Just as significantly, Senior military intelligence officers started to find experience and promotions outside of intelligence. Where intelligence careers were once stovepiped and terminal, officers with intelligence experience moved into deputy commander and deputy chief of staff positions throughout the PLA. One of the first to move was former 2PLA director Chen Xiaogong, who became a deputy Air Force commander in 2009. His successor at 2PLA, Yang Hui, became chief of staff of the Nanjing Military Region and continued through 2017 as chief of staff for the Eastern Theater Command. Other figures from technical reconnaissance and signals intelligence also started moving, such as signals intelligence chief Wu Guohua, who in 2011 became a deputy commander of the 2nd Artillery, China's conventional and strategic missile force. On November 26, 2015, Xi Jinping announced a wide-ranging set of organizational reforms that affected the PLA, from the CMC down to the lowest soldiers. These reforms fundamentally reshaped the PLA's organization of intelligence. The technical reconnaissance or collection elements within 2PLA and the General Staff Department's 3rd Department, 3PLA, were moved into the newly created Strategic Support Force alongside other electronic and information warfare elements. Technical reconnaissance bureaus from the military services also moved under this new force, leaving only a limited capacity within the theater commands. The Strategic Support Force centralized tactical and operational intelligence, making it easier from a technical and organizational perspective to fuse intelligence for battlefield commanders. Minus its technical components, such as the Aerospace Reconnaissance Bureau, 2PLA became the Intelligence Bureau of the Joint Staff Department. The implications of the change remain unknown because of a dearth of information. One knowable Chinese interlocutor suggested the Intelligence Bureau would be a more focused body for supporting the CMC and other top-level decision-makers, undistracted by the immediate needs of warfighting and battlefield support. This individual thought that, if anything, the influence of the Intelligence Bureau would increase. One of the potential downsides of moving the technical collection resources into the Strategic Support Force, however, would be breaking up China's all-source intelligence capability. When everything existed under the General Staff Department, the deputy chief responsible for intelligence could provide an all-source perspective to the leadership. This may have been one of the reasons for the influence of leaders such as Wu Shouchuan and Xiong Guangkai. For this loss not to be felt under the new organizational structure, the PLA, or at least Xi Jinping and the CMC, would need to have established a national intelligence priorities framework and ensured that Strategic Support Force intelligence also would flow to the Intelligence Bureau. Whether these developments occurred, unfortunately, is unknowable. As military intelligence began its realignment, the MSS adopted a more aggressive posture toward collecting foreign intelligence. All signs pointed toward an opportunity for expanding the ministry's role overseas. With the PLA turning inward, even as China's going-out policy subsidized Chinese firms pursuing economic opportunities abroad, China's interests were expanding without a commensurate expansion of intelligence capabilities. The MSS bet on cyberspace, made in the 1990s, and a similar, though less successful, military effort became critical components of China's intelligence power. Computer network exploitation became the easiest way to have a turnkey collection capability without the investment of time and money in training case officers and analysts to understand and operate in a foreign environment, especially with the past intelligence purges weakening China's human intelligence capability. The movement of information into digital form and its storage on computer networks created a dreadnought moment worldwide for signals intelligence collection and close-in technical operations. Just as the 1906 launch of HMS Dreadnought with its long-range guns reshaped naval warfare and nullified the British naval advantage over Germany, the emergence of computer network exploitation reshaped technical collection. During the Cold War, the Western and Soviet bloc intelligence services engaged in a no-holds-barred competition to collect secrets. As new technical operations were uncovered by the adversary, Each side learned new techniques and turned them around in the field against third country targets, creating bugs for typewriters and listening devices inside wall panels became an artisanal craft. China's autarkic self-reliance policies under Mao after 1949 isolated China's intelligence services from most of this experience, and spying domestically never required the same degree of technical sophistication that Western and Soviet bloc intelligence needed to apply. Just as importantly, the 1930s and 1940s saw the emergence of machine encryption requiring the use of early computers to break. The achievements of the CRMC Second Bureau were not primarily in the field of cryptography. The Bureau exploited captured codebooks and direction finding rather than learning how to organize a systematic code-breaking effort comparable to the US and UK efforts to break German and Japanese codes. With the 1960s Sino-Soviet split, Beijing lost much of its access to modern technologies. Cold War signals intelligence, however, required the resources of an advanced industrial state, and China lagged behind. The PLA reportedly would not learn about modern techniques, such as telemetry analysis, until Washington approached Beijing for cooperation in replacing the U.S. listening facilities lost in the Iranian Revolution of 1979. Actually breaking computer-encrypted communications remained beyond the reach of Beijing's spy apparatus. Computer network exploitation changed everything for Chinese intelligence, both civilian and military. The craft of technical operations shifted from the elegance of the device and its delivery to the elegance of the software. Moreover, the Internet enabled global reach without a global network of listening posts, satellites, and intelligence officers. Chinese military and intelligence thinkers understood this shift in the 1990s, but a decade would pass before the scope of Chinese activity became clear. Leaks from the U.S. government suggested Chinese intelligence was targeting U.S. military and corporate networks as early as 2003 in a series of intrusions collectively known as Titan Rain. The British government, probably in cooperation with the United States, also identified the same hackers getting inside government networks, including the Foreign Office and the House of Commons. Forensic investigations beginning in the late 2000s would reveal far-reaching networks of infected hosts across the private and public sector. The first public report to reveal the scope of this activity came from the Canada-based Citizen Lab in 2009, which investigated Chinese intrusions into computers owned by the Tibetan government in exile. As the investigators unraveled the command and control network and traced infected machines, they found more than 1,000 infected hosts in 103 countries. These exploits allowed the Chinese side to access and edit files, surreptitiously use microphones and web cameras, and collect emails. This intrusion set, called GhostNet, would soon be followed by public exposure of other wide-ranging efforts for intelligence collection and intellectual property theft, notably Aurora in 2010, and Shady Rat in 2011. These widespread intrusion sets marked the clear emergence of computer network exploitation as a go-to part of the Chinese intelligence toolkit. Most importantly, some of the Chinese intrusions clearly focused on providing operational support to other intelligence operations at home and abroad. In the penetration of Google's networks in Operation Aurora, Chinese hackers sought files on the Google accounts related to Chinese individuals that were covered by a legal intercept warrant. This information would show whom the Federal Bureau of Intelligence and other parts of the U.S. intelligence community was tracking inside the United States. The breaches of Anthem Insurance and the Office of Personnel Management, made public in 2015, compromised the personal information of more than 20 million current and former U.S. government employees. Although attribution of the attack was never firmly settled publicly, U.S. counterintelligence officials admitted that China appeared to be using the data to target U.S. officials for recruitment. The data taken in these intrusions suggests the MSS was behind them, because the PLA would not necessarily have human intelligence capabilities for follow-on exploitation. This operational integration showed China posed a different intelligence threat than it once did, marrying sophistication to scope and scale. One of the striking points of Western reporting on Chinese computer network exploitation is focus on the PLA almost to the exclusion of the MSS. The intrusion sets, such as Titan Rain, amalgamated a large amount of activity coming out of China, but rarely specified whether the MSS or its military counterparts were behind them. The PLA became more exposed because digital forensics married with organizational mapping of the military cyber units. This combination is what allowed the U.S. Department of Justice to issue an indictment for 5 PLA hackers working for 61398 unit of 3 PLA. The PLA simply was louder, and its greater organizational transparency allowed foreign analysts to trace activity directly back to military office complexes. The MSS, however, was significantly more discreet. The first conclusive public trace of an intrusion to the MSS did not occur until May 2017. Consequently, it is doubtful anyone outside the ministry has a clear sense of how successful it has been at collecting intelligence abroad. A new minister, Gong Wei Cheng, took over in August 2007 after a mistress-related scandal toppled several government ministers, including MSS chief Xu Yongyue. Unlike his predecessors, Gong was an intelligence professional focused internationally rather than domestically. The beginnings of his career are murky, but he may have entered the CID before becoming one of the principal America watchers at the MSS Bureau, known publicly as the China Institutes of Contemporary International Relations. When he took over the MSS, Gong may have been the right man at the right time for his service. The PLA was turning inward, and the bureaucratic shifts offered the MSS an opportunity to showcase its growing sophistication abroad. One Western study of Chinese foreign policy making during this time suggested MSS influence on foreign policy was on the rise, due in part to its domestic power. Such influence on the part of intelligence services usually occurs because they are useful contributors to the process. The MSS also strung together a solid decade of counterintelligence successes against Taiwan and the United States beginning in 2003. The most significant MSS success was the dismantling of CIA operations in China between late 2010 and late 2012. In 2010, the MSS began running a series of dangles at CIA and Allied intelligence services to draw out case officers. One of the more believable efforts harvested a throwaway covert communications system from the CIA. Using an expendable system with an agent whose bona fides are suspect is normal operational practice. However, the CIA reportedly connected that system to the internet-based system that it was using for its vetted and committed Chinese agents. Before the connection was shut down, the MSS, in cooperation with military signals intelligence, gathered a large number of operational leads that it subsequently tracked down. At least 20 Chinese agents working for the CIA were arrested and executed. From the vantage point of 2018, Chinese intelligence has arrived as an indisputable global power. Other intelligence systems may be superior in specific ways or in specific capabilities, but Chinese capabilities across the board cannot be dismissed or underestimated. The Chinese services have demonstrated the ability to collect intelligence abroad using creative methods and to shut down the principal intelligence threats operating inside China. Putting it all together, the evolution of the CCP and PRC intelligence apparatus demonstrates that bureaucracy and politics mark this history at least as much as the prurient sensationalism that accompanies much writing about intelligence. China's intelligence officers of today may be the inheritors of the Sunzi Bingfa, art of war, but ancient tradition is a poor substitute for practical experience. The CCP Eminence Grise Zhou Enlai told Henry Kissinger as much during the latter's secret mission to Beijing in July 1971. As Kissinger waxed lyrical about the mystery of China, Zhou admonished him, "You will find China not mysterious. When you have become familiar with it, it will not be as mysterious as before. These broad brushstrokes of Chinese intelligence history show the perils of ideological politics and dramatic changes. Although the definitive work of Chinese intelligence history cannot be written until the archives become available, the performance of CCP intelligence during the Mao years is decidedly mixed. In closing his noteworthy study of European intelligence performance from World War I through World War II, the historian Ernest May observed that the organization of intelligence services seemed to have no bearing on the success or failure of those services. The intelligence services, however, that frequently reorganized and rewired themselves consistently underperformed. It is doubtful the history of Chinese intelligence will show differently. The current structure of Chinese intelligence, dating to the establishment of the MSS in 1983, has proven the most durable since the CCP first created professional intelligence units in 1927. Beijing has used it as the foundation to support intelligence and covert action missions concerning Taiwan, Falun Gong, and now counterterrorism, with ad hoc interagency task force-like agencies. The current structure has proven stable, at least in part because it contained enough flexibility with a broad structure stretching from Beijing to the provinces and into the localities. The language Chinese intelligence uses reflects its Marxist, Leninist, and revolutionary heritage. The lexicon suggests, as has been borne out in interviews with former officials who had routine contacts with their Chinese counterparts, that the intelligence services are bastions of faith in the CCP. Although they may be practical in terms of techniques and methods to acquire intelligence, this information is filtered through a Marxist-Leninist lens. The implication is that foreign targets are viewed in the worst possible light. The CCP's method of developing policy from objective and scientific laws of social economic development means that policy failures are often viewed as the result of external interference. The Chinese intelligence services, judging from our research, have internalized that perspective and indeed may be the chief instrument through which Mao Zedong's paranoia is reinforced. The most important implication of this finding is that intelligence analysis within the Chinese intelligence services may not resemble the empirical, positivist tradition that permeates Western intelligence. Instead, routine intelligence analysis may be politicized by highlighting reporting that reinforces the future anticipated by scientific Marxist analysis. Conversely, the CCP has proven durable precisely because the party has demonstrated flexibility in the face of unwanted realities. Both the MSS and its military counterparts have demonstrated several ways around this politicization. According to one knowledgeable foreign intelligence officer, MSS analysis is conducted by close advisors of the vice ministers and ministers from within their offices. Such analysis is given directly to the leaders with limited dissemination. The standing of vice ministers and ministers allows more direct and truthful evaluation than would otherwise be possible. Additionally, a number of recent espionage cases highlight the case officers asking their sources to provide their assessment of large intelligence questions based on reading and interviews. This allows the intelligence service to relay such reports without having to commit ideological infractions that might have political consequences later. Notes on bibliography. We avoided most online references except for official CCP and PRC government websites, but even these were used sparingly in favor of published books and articles. Though the online Chinese encyclopedia Baidu Baike, which some consider semi-official, often contained relevant material, its articles were used only in a few cases because footnotes are sometimes inconsistent and the articles can be edited by any registered user. By contrast, the Wenku, or library section of Baidu, contains portable document format files with more useful published articles. How to use the primer. This volume has sections that will appeal to both general interest listeners who wish to better understand modern China and espionage in general, and to specialists in fields such as intelligence and security, recent Chinese history, and the politics of the PRC. Foreign guests, who travel to and live in China, whether as tourists, diplomats, business people, or others, often wonder about surveillance and how it works. In Chapter 7, they will find factual information, as opposed to the usual rumors about how the host government conducts surveillance. Students of the Chinese language will benefit from the combined use of Chinese characters with pinyin romanization in the web-based glossary of Chinese espionage and security terms that shows how the jargon has evolved over the decades. A timeline reveals how Chinese communist intelligence operations have influenced history and vice versa. Reference chapters on operations, cases, and notable spies reveal the Chinese Communist Party's focus on intelligence and security as a core business from its early days. Wherever possible, we have cross-referenced findings between communist and non-communist sources. When it was not, we have carefully examined available evidence and excluded points that appear mistaken or exaggerated. We welcome inquiries from scholars who can point out errors and omissions. The endnotes include URLs in some instances. These can quickly change, but articles on this topic once posted are more often moved by a web administrator than censored and deleted. Therefore, if a URL does not work, try using keywords to search for the reference. Quite often, the article you seek will appear on another page or site. Beyond the contents of this book, you will find an online reference, a glossary of Chinese espionage and security terms, at ccpintelterms.com. We had only limited access to official Chinese lists of terms, such as Xiyong Gong An Xiao Cidian, an unclassified public security dictionary. However, the bibliography shows that we examined many other works on CCP intelligence and security history for relevant phrases. The resulting product should be of use not only to students of the Chinese language, but also to a broad range of others interested in China and in espionage. We expect to expand this list in coming editions as more material emerges on the Chinese services, allowing improved understanding of this hitherto underexplored topic. 1. Chinese Communist Intelligence Organizations. Soviet agents in Shanghai helped organize fledgling Chinese Marxists even before the founding of the Chinese Communist Party, CCP, in July 1921. They schooled its leaders in clandestine methods, though not all were apt students. After the CCP was formed, Moscow used the Communist International, Comintern, their wholly controlled instrument, to orchestrate policy and even some operations. An often contentious secret relationship was born. After 1949, it became the Sino-Soviet friendship, lasting until 1960. This interpretation is no anti-communist trope. CCP-approved literature published in China presents many details. The organs of CCP intelligence also had direct help from Russian advisors, an even more inconvenient truth given the assassinations and other violence associated with the OGPU, Unified State Political Directorate, NKVD, People's Commissariat for Internal Affairs, KGB, Committee for State Security, and their modern successors. A significant number of Chinese intelligence officers, possibly hundreds, were trained in Russia, starting in 1926 with Chen Geng and Guo Xuanzheng. In the 1930s, Zhou Enlai loaned Chinese comrades to Soviet military intelligence, the GRU, or Main Intelligence Directorate. They were trained and deployed in networks that kept tabs on Japanese forces in China. However, the CCP's espionage services should not be characterized as a tool of the Russians, especially after 1939 when Kang Sheng took formal control. With the approval of Mao Zedong, Kang and his deputy Li Kanong aggressively spied on the GRU station in Yan'an in 1940 through 44. Moreover, Mao approved the removal of Russian advisors from inside the CCP security services over a year before the Sino-Soviet split of 1960. Afterward, there is no evidence of other foreign advisors, only intelligence liaison, such as with the Americans between the Richard Nixon visit in 1972 and the end of the Cold War. The main subject? Information about their common enemy, Russia. Foreign influence notwithstanding, CCP intelligence organizations have consistently focused on contemporary problems and perceived threats. A nearly fatal lack of intelligence capability, 1927, the need to re-establish clandestine networks in enemy-occupied cities, 1934 through 39, an outmoded revolutionary organization retooled for the needs of a nation-state but interrupted by the Korean War, 1949 through 53, an incomplete and fractured foreign intelligence structure needing consolidation as China sought its place in the world, 1955, and an intelligence and counterintelligence community, shattered by the Cultural Revolution, facing renewed foreign espionage threats with the opening of China, 1983. In 2016, China's seven military regions were replaced by five theater commands, and military intelligence was reorganized. Analysts have wondered whether the other shoe would drop. Another reorganization of civilian intelligence, the Ministry of State Security, MSS, and possibly of the National Police, the Ministry of Public Security, MPS. Accelerated campaigns to combat corruption inside the party state and to counter foreign spying heralded at least rearranged tasks for the MSS and MPS, with the former renewing its focus on counterintelligence at home and foreign espionage abroad. Our thesis about CCP intelligence organizations says that they regularly struggle to keep up with the times and reorganize their way forward like the services of many other nations. This idea runs contrary to the Beijing-approved narrative found in books, television programs, and movies. The script for public consumption emphasizes the heroics of friends and the atrocities of enemies. At times, it reads like an updated rendition of The Water Margin, Chui Hu Juan, one of the four great classical novels of Chinese literature. The CCP scripted drama of their hidden battlefront, Yinbi Jian Xian, boosts the party's legitimacy, showing that patriotic Chinese support the CCP no matter who is in charge or what deed is expected. It seems to tell today's citizens that just as it was patriotic to be a communist before 1949, so it is today. This belief system underlines that mistakes will eventually...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.